We will continue with Fahri Koray Sakarya from Boğaziçi University by the title of Industrial Wastewater Treatment by an Algae Bacteria Consortium.
Good morning and welcome everyone. Before I start, I want to present my condolences for those who suffered from the big disaster. Now I'm going to start my presentation entitled Industrial Wastewater Treatment by an Algae Bacteria Consortium. Sorry. As Dr. Carneiro also stressed out, this is about what we do is about water. We have a water problem. We will have a water problem awaiting us. And actually, it's a problem also for the present time. Over half a billion people lack access to safe drinking water. And when we consider seasonal fluctuations, over 4 billion people have water scarcity at least 1 month. And Turkey is a part of it also. We have water scarcity in some seasons. And water withdrawal is increasing day by day. And this water becomes wastewater, and we need to treat this wastewater to sustain our freshwater resources. So our project is about industrial wastewater treatment, and industrial wastewater contain heavy metals and benzyl chromium chlorides, emerging contaminants, and these contaminants bear a high risk to our water resources. And these emerging contaminants, because their fraction in chemical oxygen demand is small, they are also called micropollutants, and which makes them problematic in wastewater treatment, because their treatment is in conventional treatment systems is poor, because they are a low fraction of COD. They are not treated with the COD. Benzyl chromium chlorides are a type of emerging contaminants. They belong to quaternary ammonium compounds. They are widely used as disinfectants. As you know, in this previous COVID term, our use of disinfectants increased. These are a major part of these disinfectants. And actually, they are good at killing bacteria. They are good, really, they kill bacteria. But they eventually go into wastewater, and eventually untreated, they are going into the water systems, water bodies. And presence of benzyl chromium chlorides in water bodies in the subinhibitory concentrations may lead to dissemination of antimicrobial resistance. So our main objective in this study was to develop a consortium of algae and bacteria to remove heavy metals and benzyl chromium chlorides from the industrial wastewater. For this, we chose a bacteria and an algae. Our bacteria is Pseudomonas species Biomig1, which can degrade benzyl chromium chlorides and many other emerging contaminants. But they are non-tolerant to copper. When copper is applied, their benzyl chromium chloride degradation inhibited. And we chose algae as Tetracelmis suecica, which is tolerant to copper. Actually, you can see in the poster area my poster about screening the tolerance of some algae to copper, to heavy metals, and we found this one is the most tolerant to copper and some other metals. And we chose the synthetic medium as FO2, growth medium of Tetracelmis suecica. And then our question is, can bacteria degrade, but can it complete its job in this FO2 media? And what we observed was the bacteria cannot degrade bugs in the FO2 media. We also add ammonium for maybe it's the lack of ammonium, but it doesn't change anything. So we diluted the seawater needed for preparation of this media. And afterwards, we see an efficient bug removal in fourth diluted. Diluted 1/4 F over 2. It's not around 30 ppm. 30 parts per thousand salt, but it's prepared with 8 parts per thousand salt. So, as we change the medium, we need to check can algae grow in this medium, and we observed by density and by cell counts, algae grew well in this ionic low ionic strength medium. Afterwards, we just wanted to observe how this mixing of these two organisms, how can they treat copper and buck. For this purpose, we prepared 3 million cells per ml algae and around 10 to the 8 cells per ml bacteria constantly. We add them and we add varying amounts of copper because we know copper is toxic to bacteria, and we add 20 ppm buck and we replenished as it depleted. And we observe if there is bug removal, stable bug removal. And when we don't add copper, you can see there is stable bug removal. And we also measure bug via HPLC and copper via ICP-MS to see if also copper removal is good. So when we add copper, the removal of bug in bacterial and consortium sets. In the bacterial sets, at 0.1 and 0.5 ppm copper, there is a stable, regular removal of bug as we replenish bug. But at 1 ppm, there was a delay. In the consortium sets, there was a delay even at 0.1 ppm copper addition. And delay is increasing as the copper concentration increased. So let's look at the copper removals. As you can see, at fourth day, there is almost 50 ppm, 50% copper removal up to 1 ppm copper by the consortium. So
when we add copper, the removal of bug in bacterial and consortium sets. In the bacterial set, at 0.1 and 0.5 ppm copper, there is a stable, regular removal of bug as we replenish bug. But at 1 ppm, there was a delay. In the consortium sets, there was a delay even at 0.1 ppm copper addition, and delay is increasing as the copper concentration increases. So let's look at the copper removals. As you can see, at fourth day, there's almost 50 ppm, 50% copper removal up to 1 ppm copper by the consortium. So we want to check how algae and bug are how algae presence affects bug removal kinetics. So we remove bacteria. We just made some experiments with algae and bug and copper. With or without copper, we set up some experiments and see how bug levels are changed. And we saw in the abiotic controls where only copper is present, there is no change and is future you expected. Okay, when we observe algae set and algae plus copper set, there is a decrease in the bulk levels. Decrease in algae is less than decrease in copper, yeah, more decrease in copper added algae set. Then this should be some absorption or something. So we want to check this absorption thing. And so we extracted bug from this set with an extraction method, and then we measured bug, and we did our usual method, and we compare the results of them. So as you see, from the abiotic controls and what we have, as we know, actually we saw extraction recovery as 100%, and afterwards, as we look at the algae bearing and algae copper bearing sets, we saw 60% of actual bug observed in the extracted set in the non-extracted set. So some of them, actually 40%, goes to absorption. Yeah, we don't see it. It's actually it's there, but we only see it when we extract it properly. For the algae plus copper set, we saw 30-35% of the actual bugs. So it's a clear view of absorption. We didn't compare the lower level bug sets because in the extracted also we don't observe any bugs in the reactors. So we need to determine if there is a biotransformation of bug by algae. We didn't know before, but then we observed some evidence for biotransformation. So we set up new reactors for biotransformation by algae, 3 million cells and 10 ppm bug, 6 million cells and 20 ppm bug cells were set up. And then as depleted, we replenished bug, and we saw there is clearly bug biotransformation by algae at both sets. And you may see 2 days solid retention in 10 ppm bug set and 4 days solid retention in 20 ppm bug set. So to conclude, Tetraservis Suezica in consortium can remove almost 50% of the copper in the reactors in synthetic media, and bug removal can be stably done as replenished by the consortium in the absence of copper. In the presence of copper, we saw there was a delay, and also we saw absorption to algae biomass as a removal mechanism, as a major removal mechanism, when bug levels are higher, and when bug levels were lower, biotransformation predominated. So we have some questions for future studies also, because this is an ongoing study. And these questions are, can algae help bacteria to gain bug, like via provision of oxygen? Can we determine this? And the other one, would copper assimilation or bug biotransformation be the same when only algae, not bacteria, only algae was in play? So thank you, and if you have any questions.
Thank you. My question is, if algae is absorbing the material, the bug and what you mentioned, the heavy metals, the copper, right? So if they're absorbing it into their biomass, what's going to be the fate of this algae? We're not going to present it again to the environment, right?
I'm sorry, can you repeat?
What's the fate for the final fate? What will happen to the algae there? If they've consumed it, it's absorbing their biomass.
Oh yeah, it's assimilated, the copper is assimilated into the biomass, and actually biomass is very high. Yeah, it's living. For example, I didn't show you the level of the biomass, yeah, how algae density is increasing or decreasing, but it's stable at 3 million cells per mR. It's stable, it's not decreasing and it's not increasing.
So maybe it's
Are you asking what's going to happen to heavy metal or is algae?
Algae contain the heavy metal and the harmful material. We can't really give it to a feedstock or any other.
You can use as biofuel, for example. Yeah. And maybe for copper, I don't know, but for some metals, you may recover the metals because now it's not in the liquid phase, but it's in the algae, so and it's settled. You can remove it and recover metals from the algae.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Thank you for the presentation, Dr. Sakharyan.